When discussing battles, we have the modern advantage of experiencing them through simple, clear-cut diagrams. Unfortunately, reality never is so simple. Rather than experiencing combat like this, our ancestors experienced it like this. Having a hard time telling what's going on? How about now? And now? This all goes to show that visibility on the battlefield was clearly imperfect, even under the best conditions. This raises the question, was friendly fire an issue? A huge thanks is owed to Ancient Warfare Magazine for sponsoring this video. Well, when it comes to friendly fire, this will generally occur for the following reasons: collateral damage, panicked flight, and misidentification. Let's now take a look at each of these. The first category is the most straightforward and basically just means that troops accidentally hit their comrades in the process of attempting to target the enemy. This might occur in close quarters combat if someone mishandled their sword or spear. While we don't really have any records of this sort of thing occurring, it seems almost inevitable that it would have happened every once in a while. Roman commanders such as Caesar were careful to ensure that their troops maintained proper spacing to allow them to fight more effectively and avoid such issues. Friendly fire could also be a risk from ranged weapons. Typically, skirmishers fought each other in the opening stages of battle before retreating behind the main line to wait out the fight or move to support the flanks. In this case, commanders were always careful to stop firing once hand-to-hand combat was underway. It would be rare for units like archers to continue to fire upon the main battle lines into mixed combat. We do have some records of it happening though, when weather conditions like wind caused volleys to accidentally swerve into friendly forces. A little closer to the front lines, it was also pretty common for troops to hurl close-range javelins or even stones at each other. Once again, we can imagine some of these being thrown a little too low and hitting an ally in the back. However, this sort of collateral damage was more of a freak accident than a common occurrence. Another important type of friendly fire to discuss will be in cases of panic. Now, this was a common occurrence since typically all battles ended when one side eventually broke and fled. In fact, most casualties during actual combat would be in the low 1 to 5%, with the real terrible damage being inflicted upon the retreat. Now, generally, the casualties here would be dealt by the victorious soldiers who pursued on foot or more likely on horse. But in these situations, friendly forces could be just as deadly. This might simply be the case of people being trampled to death by a crowd as an entire battle line disintegrated into a mass of fleeing bodies. In a lot of cases though, battle lines would break apart bit by bit. Sometimes, units that attempted to flee would be blocked by their own soldiers. In these instances, we have numerous records to support the idea that fleeing soldiers would readily hack through their own lines to reach safety. Officers might attempt to hold the line and even strike down fleeing soldiers to reinstill discipline, but this would only make them a larger target for the truly desperate in the grips of Phobos. This very thing had happened to Caesar at Dyrrhachium when he was nearly killed by a fleeing soldier whilst attempting to rally the line. Apparently, some armies were ready for this sort of thing and barred the way, ready to stop or even kill any who attempted to flee. The Roman triarii were to be employed in this way as a last line of defense against both friend and foe. Some Germanic tribes apparently even had their women and children in the back lines ready to kill any cowards who retreated. So yeah, in the case of panicked flight, I'd say friendly fire was actually quite common. Next up, we have cases of misidentification. The basic idea here is that soldiers attack a target intentionally, but as a result of some confusion taking place. In approaching this topic, we will have to consider how soldiers identified their enemies in the first place. Well, to put things simply, the rank and file soldier basically attacked whatever was in front of them, and it would be the job of the general to aim them in the right direction. The way this worked is that the commander would navigate the army on a strategic level. A foe would be located through intelligence gathering, with one or both armies closing the distance for a fight. At this point, the battle plans would be drawn, and the armies deployed in accordance to these plans. As we discussed in a previous video, these sorts of battle plans in the past were really quite simple. Due to the limited and rigid nature of ancient combat, as compared to our vast and fluid modern equivalent. Skirmishers would typically screen the deployment of the armies, but once the main lines were ready, they would advance in pretty much a straight line. To the average soldier on the ground, the enemy would start off as a blurred line on the horizon. As they approached, horses could be distinguished from the men, and banners would be seen waving in the wind. Soon after, individual soldiers could be made out. At this point, it would be rather easy to identify the enemy. Distinctive equipment, cultural appearances, banners, emblems, and war cries would all be a major indicator of whom one was fighting. As a Roman, it would be fairly easy to tell who was a Greek, a barbarian, or a Persian. But what would happen if the enemy was a Roman, as was all too often the case in the civil wars? Well, things might be a little more tricky, since weapons, language, behavior, and appearance were pretty similar. The sort of confusion that could result from this is best evidenced by the Battle of Delium in 424 BC during the Peloponnesian War. Often cited as the first historical record of friendly fire, Athenian hoplites attempted to surround a unit of Thespians, but in the process ended up bumping into their own ranks and fighting one another. It is often thought that in this instance, the Athenians were not employing any specific identifiers on their shield. However, individual legions were actually fairly well differentiated by their standards and shield patterns. Since they typically stayed as a single unit rather than being split up in a civil war, the differences between armies would be pretty apparent. Judging by history, the Romans didn't really have too much trouble with these affairs, so we can conclude that proper identification was just not a big deal. Yet precautions were still taken. Often, armies would employ special passwords or chants to identify one another. Other times, units might be ordered to alter their appearance by, for example, fastening colored cloth on their person, or by leaving one shoulder bare, as was the case with Caesar's Gallic auxiliaries. But even this could not entirely prevent rare cases of friendly fire. Our most common examples take place in truly chaotic situations, like night battles or sieges. I'll share two anecdotes to this effect. The first has to do with the Athenian invasion of Sicily. The situation was that the Athenians and their allied forces from Argos were attempting to attack the Syracusans at night. On the approach, the Argives began singing a war song in their native Dorian Greek, a dialect which was different than the allied Athenian Attic Greek, but was actually the same as the enemy Syracusans Greek. The result was that in the darkness, the Athenians panicked and attacked the group chanting in a foreign tongue. Apparently, the Argives attempted to clear up the issue by shouting out the code word. However, the Syracusans who were nearby overheard the commotion, realized what was happening, and now joined in on the battle while also shouting the code word, making a right proper mess of the situation. Another example of friendly fire takes place during the siege of Jerusalem. Here, Roman soldiers ended up fighting one another in the dark passages of the Antonia Fortress. The confusion stemmed from the obscured environment and the fact that Jewish forces had actually made a habit of wearing any Roman armor they could scavenge from the battlefield. Thus, in conclusion, we could say that friendly fire was definitely a factor in the ancient battlefield, but that its risk really depended on the type in question. I absolutely love exploring topics like this one that so rarely get covered in traditional discussions of the battlefield, and hope that you've enjoyed the chat. If you like this type of content, definitely check out Ancient Warfare Magazine, our sponsor, which has fantastic coverage of all kinds of great subjects, and I'm buddies with them. Also, be sure to subscribe to the channel, ring the bell, and check out the rest of our content. See you in the next one.